66. Here for a video. I don't know if it's gonna be a real long video or a real boring video, but it's kind of my wrap up of the 2021 National Sports Card Convention that we just completed in Chicago. I waited a couple days before doing it because when I first got home, I was like literally physically and mentally beat, almost as if I'd gone on an Everest expedition. Great time. A lot of things to cover probably. But I think I actually covered everything I wanted to say, I covered in the video that you just watched. That's my feelings as a long-term collector and passionate hobbyist. These aren't the same thoughts and emotions that come from people that have been in the hobby a very short period of time, whose life experiences and soul are not invested in this hobby. But to me, I wanted to open up with some images of, I think that was circa early 1970s, 73, I think, of what it was like to go to a card show, where things weren't in shiny slabs and people weren't out making productions to make it all about them. It was all about the cards, and it was all about the kids and all about the collectors and all about the players. And that is part of the hobby that is so important to me, and that I, despite this being a monstrously well-attended and enthusiastic show, I really think that the heart and soul of a sports enthusiast and a lover of tradition and a lover of the history of all sports and the history of collecting, if we forget about that, I don't think that the hobby will sustain itself with the growth and enthusiasm that I think that we all want. So I like to go back and remind myself from whence we came. And thinking back to shows through the 70s and 80s, what was it all about? And it was a lot about the items there for sale or trade, the cards, the magazines, the memorabilia. But for the most part, it's about the memories. When I think about shows way back in the day, I think about, hey, one of my first love and girlfriend went with me to a show this long ago, or my dad, you know, was holding my hand walking the aisles of a Glenwood Motel show in the mid early 70s in Overland Park. Where we would go to lunch at Burger King with some of the icons of the hobby, the legends, the giants that some went on to do great things for the hobby and some went to prison. And I'm hoping that as the years go by for you, collector and hobbyist, that you respect the past and you respect where things came from, because like anything, if you don't know what your predecessor was or what the history of some event or was, then you really are missing out a lot. And so that was my little homage with history, with friends, with gaiety that I wanted to show there. And I do think that the best times are ahead for the hobby. Now, as far as the show itself, Kate and I think he worked Tuesday night. I think I worked until Tuesday at 7. Slept, got up pretty early and drove, I think it was 5.5 hours from the St. Louis area into Chicago. And I wanted to time it. I wanted to miss traffic, but I also wanted to see if I could catch a couple hours of the show, get checked in. And that's what we did. We timed it just right and got to the show, got our VIP passes, and I think the doors were going to open. I think at 3:30 or so. We got a little earlier than that. We went to the VIP get together, and that's when I knew that this thing was crazy, because this was in a major, huge ballroom, and it was packed and standing room only, and that's just for the people with the VIPs. So we met up with down there in the lobby of this Stevens Convention Center with let's see, Josh and Mike, Baseball Collector, and Andy, Blind Me for Factors. I don't want to keep talking about YouTube names. Let's just call them by their names. I think Eric was there, and essentially they were getting early because I think they had other passes. And thankfully, I need to get to PSA because I had one card that I brought that I wanted to do a crossover from SGC. They brought that in for me, so I didn't have to stand in this terrible line, and I will show you that crossover as able. So the first day, got there Monday or Wednesday. We tooled the floor for a couple hours, and it was really, really busy. It was really, really large. I think that there's probably the same amount of tables as there always was at Chicago, maybe a little more, especially up on the stage area. There's a lot more cards for sale up there. But anyway, we ate, him and I ate out, took a little walk. Sorry. Sorry about that. I got a call in the middle of that. But anyway, took a little walk, ate, and called it a day. Thursday was a huge day, hanging out with friends, walking the floor. I think my overall impression was of the show, it was massively attended. Very, very, very crowded. All the days I was there, we were there through Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. We planned on going staying all the way through Saturday, but we ended up leaving Saturday because just exhaustion. We'd kind of done everything we needed to do and needed to get out of town. But very, very large crowds, which is great. It's great that it's so busy, but if you're wanting to kind of see everything and spend some time at the tables, you kind of had to elbow yourself in when opportunity arose, or stand one or two deep, kind of, especially if it was a busy table. So that was not really pleasant, to be honest with you. And I don't know, in Atlantic City next year, smaller venue, if it's that big, I don't know what it's going to be like. That's just going to be crazy. But this is how crowded it was. It was so crowded that on three different occasions, and we'll say four because one of them was my son, Caden, people cash out, wanted to buy something. But because the dealers were dealing with other people, specifically people who had their big Pelican cases on the counter trying to sell stuff to them, they took up all their time. And so I myself saw three people during the show walk away who had cash out, who were wanting to buy something because the dealer was too busy with people with Pelican cases on the counter who were wanting to sell their stuff. So there's a lot of people wanting to sell. I'm not a dealer, but it's my understanding the dealers did fantastic. I saw, comments that they made more money on the first day than prior years they had for the whole show, which is great. So they were obviously very busy in selling. I saw a lot of people wanting show attendees who are wanting to sell to dealers or sell and trade. So I actually saw a lot of people, looking to unload their stuff. As a collector, that's not me. I don't know. I collect. I have what I have. I do have a small amount of stuff I'm going to sell, sure, or would sell or do sell when I'm going to buy more stuff. But boy, I would hate to be attending these shows feeling like, to get this, I have to sell this, and that is the way it works sometimes, for sure. But a lot of sellers, and it shows even going way back. I mean, you can make fun of these people with their Pelican cases and these 12-year-olds with their Pelican cases, But even way back, you know, people had their briefcases and they had their leather little briefcases. And in the 80s and 90s, they had their backpacks. And that's what I carry, a backpack. But, you know, so people have always been bringing cards to show or to sell or to trade. But certainly the hobby has moved toward people turning over cards quickly, which is not a faction of the hobby that I live in, nor do I want to live in. But, you know, if you have a hobby slash industry, like sports card market has become, there's all these avenues to go down, and I can't think that any of them are harmful to any of the others. So you'd have to say that it's a good thing. You know, you just want to make sure that the only bad thing is you don't want to make sure, I would hope that people don't get overextended because of the enthusiasm of money making and rack up their credit cards and just be devastated because of it. It's, you know, I'm glad I do it for fun. And I think that 95% of my viewers do it for fun. I personally went to the show with some wish list. If you watch my prior video, I had a wish for a R303 Ted Williams, essentially his rookie. Did not see one. Stallmeyer, Willie Mays, I did not see one. I saw some Stallmeyers, saw one or two Mantles. I saw Rizzuto, a couple others, but I did not see a Mays, and I was looking for the Mays. And the 62 Sugardale Wieners Clemente, which I did not see that. So no card that I was even looking for there in this monstrous convention, no card that I wanted did I even see present there. And that's what I like to collect. I don't like to collect things that there's a bazillion of them, but I did not see any of those. So I didn't really buy a lot at all. I probably bought the least that I bought in a long time. I'll show you what I did buy, and I'll show you a crossover I did, and just another card that seemed to have a little bit of interest that I'm kind of proud of. But the show was huge. We had, there was a YouTube get together at the embassy on Thursday, and I'd gone to a trade night before that Ryan Card Cutter 2's trade night, and that was just insane. It was over at the Hyatt Hotel in one of their ballrooms, and it was just packed. It was just packed. Inside, outside, a lot of people obviously brought their cards, laid them out, and I guess there was trading going on. I don't know if there's trading going on, but who cares if there's trading going on? If there's no trading going on, more importantly, it's show and tell. And anybody that loves sports cards or collects sports cards, you want to show and tell. That's what I want to do. I mean, when I went to the convention, I brought a few cards, that it's just fun to show and tell. I mean, wasn't show and tell when you're in grade school like the greatest thing in the world? And here we are, some of us are grown men, and a lot of you are young men, and you want to show and tell. Because to be perfectly honest with you, I got my greatest joy from hanging out with the friends and for people showing me what they bought at the show. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to talk with friends, be with friends, watch them enjoy themselves, and to see what they purchased. Because you're talking about 40 and 50 year old men who had these stupid giddy look on their faces because they're buying some sports card, and the only other people that are gonna get giddy, stupid looks on their faces are us nerds. That's who's gonna have it, because their next door neighbor ain't. Their wives and lovers and girlfriends will pretend. But it's this family that is going to really appreciate it and enjoy it with you. And I honestly can say is that all of the fellow YouTubers are just as happy for you and what you experience and what you buy and what you enjoy as what they're getting for themselves. I believe that to be true, and that is the type of mentality that has to be passed on to these younger people for the hobby to grow, and at least in a what I feel is a positive way. I just want to talk about what I really feel bad about is. Not being able to have extensive or sometimes brief or sometimes any conversations with fellow YouTubers, or I'll just call them collectors, who I wanted to talk to or perhaps wanted to talk to me and the opportunity didn't present itself, or perhaps the opportunity, I can think of a couple instances where I saw people, I made eye contact, and I just never got around to talking to them. I'm not a mingler. I tend to kind of sit down, and I'm happy when people come talk to me, and I met and talked to a lot of great people. I'm really hesitant to name people, but you know how you know who you are. It's really funny is that this video thing is in many ways sterile and impersonal and almost like watching TV. And so one of the days I'm walking with Josh Rated Rookie and Andrew Nuffset Cards, and up walks Rick, who's Vintage Oddball Cards, and I'm don't want to say eBay or YouTube names, but Rick comes up, and there is Rick in person. I've never met him before, watching his videos for years, and I was like, it was like a celebrity walks up to you. And that was with many of you. I had long conversations with Dean and Ben with Dead Guy Cardboard, so many people. But Rick gave me a couple things that I'll show, really neat things. And during that, we were with Josh, who was trying to find a card that I suppose that he'll be showing. But at the YouTube get together, it was just all the guys. Everybody that watches my channel, and I think people generally who watch my channel watch your channel. They were there, and so many of them I didn't get time to talk to. I've been waiting a year to talk to Scott Scani Tradition, see him in person, and I just had enough just to say hey real quick, and Chuck Northside Guy, and so many people. I just feel bad that I hope that people don't think that I really hope you don't think that if I made eye contact with you or saw you that I ignored you or whatnot. That makes me feel bad. I'm basically shy. I'm basically not a mingler, but I really just like seeing all the people there. You know, I spent a little bit of time with JT and Mike O and Ron Figg and Brian was there. Everybody was there, and I'm glad they got to the YouTube get together because there was a lot of other opportunities. So the show itself was massive. It was massively busy. And when it's that large and it's that massively busy, to me, it becomes almost mind-numbing. I don't know. It's like, it's such a cliche, but imagine just being a six-year-old and going into Willy Wonka's this candy shop. And just, there's just too much. It was too much to concentrate. So I on, hey, I'm going to look for this. I you knew what I was looking at, but essentially I spent looking for other people and just going through to see if something caught my eye, that, hey, this, I want to go show some people, and this has got me buzzing. This has got me where I'm thinking about it, you know, that night, maybe to go back the next day, but none of that really happened. It was kind of hot the first day or two. The refreshment stands are extremely expensive. There were lines, but it wasn't like crazy. I think the people there did the best they can. They had pizza and pretzels and hot dogs and some hamburgers that, you know, they were okay. They were okay, but they're extraordinarily priced. There's a couple restrooms there, so if you need to go to the bathroom, you're gonna have to walk 15 minutes to one end or the other. I thought the people that like walking around with the cameras who are doing content, I think that they were generally not intrusive at all. I didn't even really notice them that much, you know, filling the aisles or whatnot. You know, you saw some of them, and to be honest with you, I'm getting a lot of glare. Some sunlight coming in. To be honest with you, I didn't really see people really giving them a second thought. I think those, I think most of the content I see, and I try to keep up on stuff. I mean, I'm halfway over the hill, long-term collector who poo-poos that stuff a little bit. But generally, I think a lot of this stuff is good and good for the hobby. I think that young man, that Ryan Card Cutter too, I think that he is, and I watch and I see what people are doing, and I'm usually snarky about stuff. I think he's really good for the hobby. I think he's been in the hobby long enough that he hasn't soured already. I think he is generally good ambassador. he has a shop. He sets things up to promote and help other people. And more importantly, he seems to be good and genuine with the youth. And there's a lot of content builders out there. And for the most part, I support them all, not by necessarily being a viewer or whatnot. I do have my favorites. There's only one that I can't stand. Essentially has his team and grandstands, and I think it's not good for the hobby. I think ultimately will be shown not to be good for the hobby, and I think is trying to dominate space that he has no business dominating, as far as even trying to push other people out of the content creation arena. This sunlight is crazy. So, restaurants, a few good restaurants within walking distance, not enough, I think, for as many people as you might think. Certainly could just Uber or get a Lyft. That's probably the best thing to do, but just wanted to just kind of walk around I don't think that there's enough restaurants just right there in the immediate area to support that kind of convention. We certainly had a great dinner at Gibson's with a few of us on Thursday. That was myself, my baseball collector, Eric, those back pages, Josh Ray, the rookie, Andy, she blinded me with refractors, and my son, and that. I could have just showed up Thursday, gone to the show for an hour, had dinner with them, and called it a day, and I would have called that a win for me. What else? I think it was the first day we're there, and I think I got a text from Eric Those Back Pages, and he wanted me and Caden to meet him over somewhere, so we met him, and he presented Caden with just a fantastic gift of base set first edition Pokemon energy cards set all in PSA 10. It just fantastic. I wanted to show them on this video, but Caden's already, he's at work now and he's got them squirreled away somewhere. So that is the type of, that's why, that's really why I went to the show. I just went to the show to see friends, and that just blew me away. It blew Caden away, and it made me very happy that I think that this YouTube community thinks alike in many ways. Is there more often than not thinking about other people than thinking about themselves? I think that that is just very, very, very powerful. Very powerful. I think I'll show a couple things. I kind of rambled on here, and I don't think I really even covered much. But honestly, that video I did at the beginning just said what I wanted to say. I do not want to, however, wait another year for another national before this family gets back together again. I thought about, you know, the heading or the first thing I was going to say in the video, and it was going to be, hey, I hear you went to a sports card convention. Well, I went to a family reunion. And that's what it felt like to me. You know, it felt like this once a year get together where it's people that you love and know and are friends with who every time you meet up with them, it's like you were never away. That's honestly the feeling I had. I'm not very good at goodbyes, so we would be at the YouTube. We had a couple get-togethers. We had the baseball collectors get together at the embassy on Thursday, and then Friday was the Filmington Pepino Man type get-together at Lowe's. And I had great time at both of those. Great time. And, you know, each time I just, Caden and I just slipped out because, I don't know, for me, getting up and just saying goodbye is kind of, I don't need to announce my entrance nor my exit. But they were all very good. So why don't we just take a look at a few of my pickups here, talk a little bit about it, and then we'll call a day. I think I'm gonna be disappointed in this video because I think I wanted to give a better vibe of what it felt like to be there. And I can't do it. I can't express. You know, what you can do is you can show pictures of a busy convention, and you can show pictures of cards, and you can show pictures of friends mugging up for the camera and out for a beer together, dinner together. But what you can't show on a video, and I can't express, is just the consolidation of unity of the spirit that the YouTube card collecting community has. There is, everybody, it's just a great group of men and women and boys and girls, guys and gals who have considerable interest in each other and thoughts. and goodwill. And it was such a it was such a heartwarming, good feeling, fun experience that I realized when I started to think what I was going to talk about in the video that it's just not going to, I'm not going to be able to convey it. So I'll just stop. So I'm just going to show some cards here and then we'll move on. Okay, first a couple personalized cards. First is with John Wade Boggs fan. I was happy to meet him at the Filmington get together. Number 12 of 40. It's a super nice card. Very, very well done. Auto card. Ed Weskergriff. And Mike O. Dual. Really, really cool. Got a couple things from here. Let me just see what I got here. Well, oh, Ron Figg. It's George Brett, Decade's Best. Number 50. And as I mentioned, vintage oddball collector, got me a beautiful T205 Christy Mathewson t-shirt. And this original photo, George Brett, he knew this photographer Brace, this is his photo. Really an early Brett image. Now Brett played with the, you know, his card's 75, but you know, he was in the system, the Royal system, and he came up, I believe he in 74. This is a real, real early image of him. And as a matter of fact, boy, I'm looking at that stadium. That is not Kauffman Royal Stadium, but I doubt it's the Municipal Stadium because that was through 72. But anyway, fantastic image. Okay, if you pick, I'm going to show this again just because it's cool and Fu was at the Filmington get together, and he was impressed by this card and took it from me and was showing people and passing it around. So if you got a card that Fu 3112 is impressed with, then you know you've got a good thing going because his collection is maddening. It's just crazy. But I think I showed this in my, I did, I showed this in my last video that I was bringing it for a possible trade or sale, but in actuality, there's zero chance in hell that I would ever trade or sell that. My crossover, so I did a PSA, I did a PSA crossover from SGC, this, so I had the guys bring this in for me, and then I picked it up, I got it the next day. 54 Bowman, Willie Mays. This was in an SGC 8.5. And I have a ton of SGC cards, and I love SGC, but to be honest, my mantles and my 50-60s cards, I just want them in PSA. If I'd had my rathers, my tobacco cards and pre-war cards, I'd rather them be in SGC. Many of them are. Some are in PSA. But I don't really have a uniform pre-war collection. Like my Mays collection, most of them are in PSA. But here it is a PSA 8, and it just looks fantastic. Picked up a couple the Donruss Press Proof, The Marvels. 2019. DeLuca. I will probably, I'll probably just send these to, I'll probably either leave them alone or send them to SGC. Oops, excuse me. And the LeBron. I did get a LeBron Bazooka rookie, which I love this. Notice the Marvels and the Bazooka. So I like the attachment to the, you know, the 60s, 70s type Americana stuff. So Joe Bazooka. Okay, so that was cool. I also got another Bobby Witt, the Donruss Optic, the Blue Mojo auto. He's in AAA now, right? In Omaha. So I don't know the politics of bringing people up, but you know, I wish they'd just get him up, but maybe he's not ready. I don't know, but maybe he'll be the next George Brett. Royals need something. Got this Select Herbert, blue die cut prism. I had a couple, I think, kind of pretty big Herbert cards that I picked up. I think I've said during the season last year that I unloaded early this year, kind of when the market was crazy, just to, I bought them cheap and sold them really high. But I wanted to have some representation of Herbert, so I picked up that. I picked up this set. It's not a set, it's a partial set. Famous Fighters. It's D. Cummins and Son. They are 1947. I think that they're tobacco cards and they are English. So I had never seen these before. Here's the Joe Louis. Gene Tunney. Who else we got here? Walcott here, Max Baer. It's it looks pretty mint set to me. It's missing three cards. It's missing, and they're big cards. it's missing the Sugar Ray Robinson, the Jack Dempsey, and Graziano cards. But I've checked on, I'll be able to pick those up. I'll be patient with them because I probably will end up paying for those three cards more than I paid for the remainder of this set. But yeah, that's kind of an interesting thing. So I got that. So that was my National. I'm not sure if I said anything useful in this video at all. But I did pick up a few cards and I really enjoyed myself. Caden had an absolute blast. And for those of you that inquired into Caden or said hello to him and showed him friendship, that goes with me personally beyond anything. My son is the world to me. So anybody that shows him compassion and kindness and friendship, you've got me forever. Okay, so not too long a video, could have been better, but I did want to make a video. But more importantly, I wanted to thank each and every one of you who attended the show, and those of you who are unable to. I know you wanted to, hopefully next year in Atlantic City.
But there's going to be a lot of shows in the interim. And although they won't be as big as the National, again, you'll get the biggest kick out of hanging out, being with friends, praising and admiring what other people bought, letting them praise and make goo-goo eyes over the neat things that you love and purchase. And don't wait a year. Let's not wait a year. There's a lot of shows. And I know it's time and travel and away from your family, loved ones, job, and there's expenses. But I think a year between seeing each other is too much. So look out for each other, and thanks for watching.